God bless you, my brother and sister. I am Overseer L.C. the pastor and founder of King of Kings Baptist Ministries here in the Bronxville section of the city. And it gives me a great opportunity and pleasure to invite you to one of our worship services this morning that you might experience God like you've never experienced it before.
And I am Elder Ellen Carter, First Lady of King of Kings Baptist Ministries.
Here you will find out that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we believe in worshiping God in spirit and in truth. I pray that as you view this video, that you will be able to experience God as if you've never experienced it before. So come on, go with me into one of our worship services and see what God has in store for you. Let us go now.
Come on, it's a personal relationship. Thank you. not my accident that you are here today, but it has been ordained by God that you are sitting here at this moment. This is not a mistake. This is not a test drive. God planned this a long, long time ago. So on behalf of my pastor, Overseer L.C. Carter, my First Lady, Elder Ellen Carter, and the King of Kings family, we welcome you in this place.
Hallelujah.
This is God's house. And it is operating the way God wants it to be operated. So feel free to allow the Holy Ghost to move you. Don't hold back. Don't quench the spirit if it's in you. If you want to run around,
thank you.
way we can make it without God. No way. No way. I know there's folk on every section and every section in this church to try some stuff by yourself. And it just wasn't successful. I know I tried a lot of things in this life, in this lifetime of mine. I wasn't successful. But when I said, God, I surrender and I give it all to you, I got some success today. Because there was no way we can do anything without their love.
Thank you.
If you're in here, take it out now. You are
aside to reflect on the death and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and put them together, because you got to have one with the other, death and resurrection. But this is basically the day that we set aside to remember the sacrifice that was made. It doesn't matter what Sunday you do it or what day you do it. It just says, as often as you do this, as often as you do this, you show forth suffering until you should come again, until it comes again. And the thing about this is that there was a debt that needed to be paid. Something would be a debt, ain't it? You owe somebody. The finances are few, just not coming in fast enough. Things are just not getting done. You have more bills at the end of your paycheck than you have paycheck, right? Every time you turn around, there's something new, something else happening. Well, I want to tell you something. You know, the Bible taught me, it says that you shall be the lender and not the borrower. So I say to myself that if I find myself in that position more often than not, then that means some changes need to take place. And I know we can fall on hard times, that's not what I'm saying, but I say if it happens more often than not, then we need to reevaluate ourselves and try to figure out what it is that's going wrong, because God always keeps His word. And He said He could put us in that position. We should stay in that position, being able to help others if at all possible. We know that debt had to be paid by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that we would have a right to the tree of life. And it's because of our sin, and often most people, their sin is what's keeping them down right now. And many of us have forgotten about it. It's not that we should forget it, because the thing about it is that we must, first of all, repent of it. Once you repent of it, then you can let it go. But if you have not repented, then you got to remember. But also, you have to remember that if you sin, there is still a price to pay, because the Bible says you're going to reap what you have sown.
Amen.
And we give God glory for that and honor, because the thing about it, He's going to keep His word. So whatever we're going through right now, let's just grin and bear it. Just grin and bear it. Say, you know what, I have to go through this right now. I'm not going to blame anybody else. I'm going to take responsibility for myself. in there first. They moved it and took it out, so it's not my fault.
Amen.
Because the Spirit of the Lord woke me up and told me there's nothing I can do because you have to be obedient to the Spirit of God. Amen. From the book of Colossians chapter 2, verse number 3. This is what it says. Colossians chapter 2, verse number 13. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 13. This is what it says. When you get there, amen, amen. If you're not able to stand, it's okay. We're not going to read verse number 13. If you got it, say amen. You need to hold on, say hold on. All right. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh have he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. You may be seated. Having forgiven you of all your trespasses. You know, it's good when dead get wiped out, isn't it? You get to start all over again. You get to start fresh. And the thing is that if you get to start fresh, you need to learn how not to make the same mistakes. Oh, somebody. Forgiven all. What I love about it is that God is willing today. I don't know about yesterday. I'm not going to talk about tomorrow, but I'm talking about today. He's saying today. Today, I have forgiven you all of your trespasses. You don't let nobody hold what you did against you any longer. Do not allow them to keep you bound up. Well, you can't break this thing. Don't let them speak that into your life. Don't let them tell you you will always be who you are. Because the thing about it is God can make you over again. He's the potter. We're the clay. A potter will begin to spin his wheel. And he will mold a pot. But if he looks at it and there's some imperfections, he doesn't throw the clay out. While he is molding it, if he see I just didn't get it right, while it is still pliable, while it is still soft, he will take it and just smash it down. Knead it up and roll it back up. So what you once saw was a pot will no longer be a pot, but it will just become a lump of clay. You got to tell the Lord right now, Lord, you know what? I'm imperfect, so just smash me down. Just smash me down and start all over again. Because God is able to do that when nobody else can. He can take it because we're pliable. And God said, I made you in a manner that I can begin to mold you and shape you all over again. Because, see, I'm the only one that's able to forgive you for anything that you have done prior to this moment, But you got to, first of all, begin to forgive yourself. You know, I'm sorry that I did this to myself. All I'm trying to get you to do is take ownership. It wasn't the boyfriend. It wasn't the girlfriend. It wasn't the boys. It wasn't the girls that made you do what you did. You decided. Mm-hmm, come on, somebody. You made up in your own mind that I'm going to try this, I'm going to do this, because I don't know about you, but many of us have stepped off into the deep knowing we couldn't swim. Come on, somebody. Amen. Are we going to try it? Because every other people make it look easy. Other people make it seem like it's all right, because we look at the enemy and he looks like those that are not living right are just being blessed. Amen. They don't seem to have the problems that I have ever since I accepted Jesus in my life. You're absolutely right. Because when you don't have parents at home, kids will wreck your house. They'll wreck it. There ain't nobody watching them. That's why you get a babysitter. Not just because they need somebody to feed them or whatever, because you know if you leave them home by themselves, they're going into everything, they're going to mess with everything, they're going to look in every nook and every cranny. Well, that's what you need to understand. The people of the world are running the house without any guardianship. But I don't know about you, I'm glad I got a guardian over me. I'm glad I got somebody watching me to make Rachel, I don't hurt myself also. You know what I'm talking about. Because when you were, the Bible said we're children, and children will hurt themselves.
Yeah. Right.
I'm on the phone talking to a mother, and she's up there hollering at the boy, talking about, stop that, stop that, stop that, doing that. Thing. I said, what are you doing? He's flipping all over the place. He don't have me at Children's Hospital. I said, that's what boys do. And the thing about it is, it's a good thing you're there to watch over him, because he doesn't hurt himself. Well, the thing about it is, God knows that we're children, and what we do is sin. What we do is act up. What we do is cut up. But he's watching over us and stop that. Amen. Amen. And the thing about it is, if you're in tune with God, you know the difference between mama's voice and daddy's voice. And mama might say, stop, stop, stop. But all daddy does is come and stop that boy. Amen. And you start to freeze in your tracks. And the thing about it is, once you get God in your life, you ought to have that connection that when God says, stop it, you won't be able to do that anymore. You won't want to do that anymore, because you will recognize that you're always in his presence, because God is everywhere. So whatever you get ready to do that you ain't got no business doing, you realize God's looking at you. But you need to get that mental picture in your mind that when you get ready to do wrong, God is watching you. He's looking at you at all times. He says, I neither slumber nor do I sleep. So if that be the case, even when you sleep, he's watching you. Amen, amen. When you was in the back in the dark, he was watching you. When you was slipping and dodging, he was watching you. When you didn't think the pastor saw you, he was watching you. When you didn't think your wife didn't see you, he was watching you. When you didn't think your husband didn't see you, he was watching you. Amen. You need to understand that he's everywhere at the same time.
That's God.
He's just like the parent, the mama. Yeah, the boy's cut up and the girl's cut up. But he said, look at here, no matter how much you cut up, I'm going to forgive you, because you still feed them. You still put clothes on their back. You still nurture them and you still love them. God is the same way. He said, I'm going to forgive you and I'm still going to feed you. I'm still going to clothe you. I'm going to give you water to drink. I'm going to give you food to eat. Regardless of how bad you've been, I'm still here to take care of you, because you belong to me.
Yes.
We got to get to that point. It'd be good to know that you've been redeemed.
Yes.
By the blood of the Lamb. For he forgave us of all our sins. And that's what I like about it. God is so omnipresent and so potent in himself that he said, I'm going to forgive you everything. I'm not going to hold anything against you like some of your friends. Like people that try to bring you down. I found out, see, when people want to bring up your past, the past is designed to keep you bound and keep you held fast. It's an anchor in your life. Oh yeah, that's what it is. It's an anchor. See, as long as I got you, a ship that is anchored can't go nowhere.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. And see, they don't want you going anywhere, because some people feel good about having you down. Some people feel good about looking down at you. But the thing about it is, I found out that the captain of the ship don't want the ship to sit still, and he'll call the crew and say, raise the anchor. And the thing about it is, you got to understand something. Since Jesus is the captain of your ship, he's trying to get you to raise the anchor. He said, you just bring the anchor on board. You bring that addiction on board with you. You bring that stuff that you ain't got no business on board with you. You bring that wrongdoing on board with you. You bring that lying tongue on board with you. I'm not trying to get rid of it, but I want to start managing it. I want to grab it and take control. That anchor is heavy, but when it's on the ship, the anchor won't smoke it. As heavy as the anchor is, once the anchor gets on the ship, some issues. I don't mind going to the fact that I got some problems, because I got my problems on board, rather than letting them drag behind me, because it's hard to drag your issues. Oh, come on, somebody. Yeah, that's your problem. You're dragging the issues, acting like they don't belong to you. Back here, it'll drag on the bottom, and when it drags on the bottom, have to let that stuff go. Get it on board. I know it says let go and let God. The thing about it is, I'm not letting go of my issues. Because see, the thing about it is, when you let go of it, it's still attached to you. Because people know how you work. And they know what you work. And when you let it drag, you run it down there thinking can't nobody see it. But if you drag that anchor, then all that dirt comes up. Because people will see it and say, wait a minute, they ain't moving as fast as they should. There must be a problem. And they'll look behind you and say, yeah, they got some issues back there. But see, when you know, when the anchor is up, don't nobody pay attention to it.
Right.
You ever notice that?
Uh-huh.
You don't go to the ship looking for the anchor. You go to the ship looking, oh, this is a nice ship. And that anchor means nothing to you. You ain't looking for it. You don't care where it is. But if that ship ain't moving real slow and it's dragging, you say, man, what's that back there? See, we bring notice to our own stuff. We bring notice to it. Because not only is it, do they see it, but we see it, and we allow it to stay where it is rather than bringing it on board. And if you allow it to stay where it is, it's going to do its job. Its job is, as long as I'm not close to you, I'm going to let people know that you're anchored. I'm going to let people know that you're stuck right here. I can see any ship in port that's sitting there, you can bet that it's anchored or tied down.
Amen.
It don't just sit there by itself. If it's a little boat, it's tied down. If it's a big ship, the anchor is there. Because if it wasn't, it's going to move. And then when it starts to move, if it's close to the shore or it's close to the dock, it'll probably run into the dock and cause even more damage.
Amen.
See, that's our problem. We want to be close to the shore or close to the dock, but we don't want to put our anchor down in Jesus. See, I like what I got two anchors. I got the anchor of Jesus Christ. And then I got the anchor of my mess. See, and if I'm anchored in Jesus while I'm in port, because sometimes you got to come in port. But what am I coming in port for? What I'm talking about, being anchored in Jesus, when you come in the inside of the church. When you come into the church, you are in port. Okay? What happens in port? In port, you get rejuvenated. In port, you replenish the stuff that you had to use while you were out at sea. And the thing about it is, now I'm going to drop the right anchor. Because I don't mind people seeing that I'm anchored when I come in the house of God. Because when I come in here, I'm coming to get replenished. I'm coming to restore and put back that which I used while I was out at sea. Where am I at sea? I should be out there seeking those that are lost. Seeking those that need help. Seeking those that need to know Christ for themselves. When a ship goes out to sea, it's actually now doing its job. It's transporting. It's taking things to and from one place to another. And it usually has cargo, or it might be a warship. But once it's out of port, it does what it's been called to do. If it's a warship, it might be seeking out the enemy.
Right.
If it is a cargo ship, it is taking goods from one port to another. If it's a cruise ship, it is allowing people to enjoy themselves.
Right.
I believe that as Christians, we are all three types of ship.
Right.
Sometimes you got to be a warship.
Right.
Amen. You got to seek out the enemy. We too busy letting the enemy seek us out. He waits till he run up on us, and the enemy attack just at the right time. But I found out that you need to be a warship. You need to have your radar working. Amen. Searching for the enemy while you're out there. Looking for him. Not running from him. No, we're too busy trying to run from the enemy. I'm trying to run it for my life. I ain't running for nothing. I don't have to run for my life because Jesus died for my life. That I have to run to the tree of life. So why do I got to run for it? Trying to help you here.
They knew we were the best. We were the only units in Vietnam that wore colored patches. Everybody else had subdued patches. But the reason that our patches were colored, we wanted them to see us coming. We wanted them to know that you're messing with the special forces, that we are bad men. We're bad boys. They'd run for cover because we didn't take prisoners. They'd run for cover because we destroy everything. You need to let the enemy know I'm on my way, and I'm going to destroy everything.
You're the only one. Our patches was not subdued. They were unknown for color. And when the enemy saw it, they changed their mind. Because they said, nah, these boys is too bad. We ain't got time to mess with them. And I believe that if you are really prepared, the enemy don't want to mess with you. If you're really prepared, I got to go. He really don't want to bother you. Because he understands that you are loaded for bad. He understands that you've been well trained. And you're versed. In hand-to-hand combat, because I found out that the Lord would not send you out there by yourself, because sometimes we would go out by ourselves, but I had a radio, and if I got in trouble, I would call back and say, send me a Cobra. A Cobra helicopter is a bad boy. It can fire a machine gun that we call Puff, the magic dragon, a round would hit every inch for 100 yards. Everything that was in that radius had to die. They got our life. When I get in trouble, I call for Puff. Puff God, the magic dragon. I need your deliverance. I need you to fire for maximum effect. I need you to fire and kill my enemy. Because God is able. Yes, he is. He's able. I know he's able. He's a wheel. In the middle of a wheel. He's a bridge.
Use it to your advantage. I was taught how to take
when you get important.
Yeah.
See, it's okay to put it down here.
Yeah.
Important. I can let my guard down.
Well,
all my little problems, all my little issues of life. See, the ship, when it comes into port, is coming to fix its problems.
Right, right.
Sometimes you've been in battle, and you might have a few nicks, and you might have some damage in your heart. You might have some damage on board that ship, and you say, you know what? I'm going back in port, and I'm going to put my problems out in front of everybody, because in port, this is called safe harbor. That's when you put your anchor down. When you're in the safe harbor, when you come to the house of God, you can drop that and say, okay, now let's work on my problems. Let's work on my issues. The worst thing you want to try to do, you may have to do it sometimes, but the worst thing you want to try to do is fix a leak in your boat in the middle of a battle.
Wow.
Because you know you're going to hurt, get it fixed before you sink. You hoping that you don't get damaged that bad. Because you got to take men away from what they normally would be doing in order to fix your breach. I'm just trying to help you. But if you got to do it until you get back to safe harbor. You'll be able to understand now that I don't mind being anchored in the harbor, but I don't want to be anchored out at sea because I'm a sitting duck. You can drop your anchor in the middle of a battle if you want. You are sitting up. Yeah, I don't care what's going on. You better keep on moving. Moving targets a little bit harder to hit than one to sit still. What do you mean, Pastor? Well, you know, I'm going through right now. I'm having a problem. And you ain't nowhere near the church. You sitting in your house having a pity party. That's not a safe harbor. You on the phone whining to somebody is not a safe harbor. Because you're still out, you left. This is the harbor right here. Once you leave here, you're going out to do that.
Wow.
You're going out. You just left the safe harbor. You left here saying, I'm ready.
Amen.
I left here saying, I've been trained. Yes. And I'm ready for battle. You can't get out there and say, oh, I left my ammo. But we didn't bring enough fuel. You gotta go out to prepare. Put your anchor down here and let Jesus fix you up. Let him mend you back together again. And take you. They call the experts. The men that are on the ship, they're doing temporary work to keep it afloat. When they get back, they call in the expert welders. The expert welder will come and say, okay, you did a good job. Okay, we're gonna fix this the right way. And that's what you're doing. You're patching yourself up. But you're really not qualified to do a job.
Wow.
Get back into the harbor and let professionals deal with your damage.
Yes.
And watch what God will do. I've seen ships that have holes in them, and next thing I know, later on down the line, look like the hole was never there.
Amen.
He fixed it. He put it back together again.
Hallelujah.
I know. Humpty Dumpty sat on that log. I know he had a great fall. And all the king's horses and all the king's men, they couldn't put him back together again. But God can.
Yeah.
He knows every piece. You can take an egg and throw it down. If God put it back together again, it'll be whole again. You ever try to put something back together again that you broke?
Yes.
And then later on down the line, or try to sweep it up and clean it up, and then you go back and you find another shard of glass over there and another shard over here. Never miss a shot of glass.
Yeah.
Because we want you to remain seated for a few moments, please. We want you to remain seated as well. We're not going to the back. We want you to remain seated so that you may be able to hear this presentation. Father God, we thank you for these, your people that have come to worship and praise your holy name. We thank you for the sacrament that we have now taken part in. That we remember the sacrifice that was made for our right to the tree of life. We thank you, we honor, and we glorify you with all our heart, mind, body, and soul. And now unto you that is able, we do so far. ever since now and forevermore. The Lord God's going to say amen.
Thank you.